seeing mass gatherings, marches and protests on the news. People using their voices, loudly, and their wit. Perhaps we've even taken part and felt emboldened by being a voice in the crowd, piling on the pressure to whoever. But there's a quieter form of protest emerging. One that seems more gentle, but maybe just as effective a way to get your voice heard.
I like to think that I stand up for what I believe in, so much so that I've been on plenty of marches. In fact, it's the only time I really ever get my step count properly up. And I've done all the shouting thing, but you know what? A couple of years ago, when I saw these, as worn by those attending the women's rights marches, I had to think, well, what a very good idea. These are called pussy hats, because the corners look like ears. They're handmade. Time was taken to knit these. This is a powerful gesture supporting the right of women to have rights. And the colour pink was chosen somewhat ironically to symbolise the fact that many women have no choice at all. No words are needed. Now, I've been told that this kind of thing is a form of craftivism, which is a mashup between craft and activism. And I have been tasked by the BBC to find out some more. Crystal Palace Park in South London to meet someone who in all sorts of ways represents craftivism with her street art. Over a decade ago, Lauren O'Farrell coined the term yarnstorming as knitted cosies and stitched story characters popped up across a delighted London. They were designed to brighten people's days and make them think. Even Lauren's graffiti name is a pun. She tags herself Deadly Knitshade. I've been invited to help her with a brand new graffiti project, but no knitting's involved.
So, Lauren, I'm your craft slave for the day.
You are. I like to think of you as my accomplice.
Wait till we get going. You have brought me to a plinth in Crystal Palace.
I have.
I need more explanation.
So, this is our canvas for the day.
Gotcha.
This plinth.
Yep.
So we're basically going to make some squishy street art on the plinth. We're going to fuzzy felt it today.
Right. I like the idea of fuzzy felting this plinth because I didn't want to do any graffiti in case I got into trouble.
Okay. It kind of is graffiti, but it's like squishy.
And it's,
you know,
and
like,
it's takeaway
and it reminds
graffiti.
People of their childhood, so they're like, oh, it's fine. And it comes off, so it's removable.
Love me some fuzzy felt.
Yeah, fuzzy felt.
Lucky for me, Lauren's pre-cut the letters and shapes, so all I need to do is get handy with the glue and put them in the right place.
Oh, sweetheart, you can't have any of these. And what am I fitting on this side? The word sometimes?
Yep. Hello.
Can't find my E for my sometimes.
I've got loads of them. Do you think it's one of these?
Yes, I'm having that
Just
one.
Have one. Wicked.
Ah, it's very gluey.
In our little fuzzy felt gluing collective, I learn how Lauren took up knitting while hospitalised with Hodgkin's lymphoma, a form of blood cancer. On and off over 3 years, she had four types of treatment, including stem cell replacement.
And I couldn't read all right because my brain was mush, so I learned how to knit.
I mean, that makes knitting sound easier than it is, to be honest. Because, you know, I think knitting is one of the most complicated
it is a bit.
Brain activities.
I'm realising that this graffiti is craftivism because it's meant to make people stop and think, aimed as a friendly way to help us tackle our personal demons.
They're going to be called mollified monsters.
Okay.
And they're all of the kind of like mental health issues that I or people I know have talked about. and ways to kind of combat them. So your monsters.
Yeah, so what would this monster be? What's this monster suffering from?
So this, pretty much like a whole depression thing going on, and the fact that I started to go out for walks when my depression got really bad. I just needed to go somewhere green and calm and quiet and run away from everything, basically. So this monster is doing exactly that.
So this is a happy place for you.
It is a very happy place for me, yes. I wanted to celebrate the fact that I had been through cancer and I was still alive. So I was just like, I just want a little thing that I can leave that says to somebody, yeah, I'm really excited. And, you know, I just want you to notice the world. That was my initial thought. And then after a little while, I started to realise that I actually have a voice that people are listening to, and that in that, you know, like there's some kind of responsibility to say something that's
valid.
Yeah, and to say something that might make people think a little differently, I suppose. But I think the first craftivist thing I properly did was I went down to Occupy London, which was outside St Paul's. And I made, it was a mouse, it was tiny, and it had a little sign, and on the sign it said, no more fat cats.
I am aware of this piece of work, because this hit the news, didn't it?
Yeah, so it did. So, and what I found, which really surprised me, was that people were more willing to share that mouse and the sentiment behind that mouse than they were willing to share any of the banners. They, like, that felt political to them, but the little mouse, with the sense of humour and the fact that it was cute, so they almost don't realise that it's going in.
He's like a gonk.
He is. There we go.
This phrase, Lauren, sometimes yes. You just need silence and tall trees.
Tall trees.
Did you make that up yourself?
I did. Craftivism is quite magical, really. I don't know anything that touches people's hearts quite as fast as craftivism does. People, like, connect with it straight away.
Well, what do you think of that? The glorious. It's a good job jobbed.
Well,
I think it calls for
well
a high
done,
five.
Us. High five.
One, two, three.
Well done. Good work, girls.
I can see that Lauren's Mollified Monster series has got off to a good start, judging by the looks from the public stopping to notice it. Fresh air, trees and craftivism must surely be good for our mental health. I'm curious to find out how crafting skills can be used in all sorts of ways to protest, campaign, or for our own well-being. I remember being advised to take up knitting myself to bring down my blood pressure, which had rocketed during the menopause. So I'm off to meet the UK's leading craftivist, Sarah Corbett. She's the founder of the Craftivist Collective, a network that encourages people to use craft as a force for good.
Hello.
Hiya, Jenny. Do you want to come in?
I'd love to. Thank you very much.
Do you want a cup of tea?
I'd love one. So, Sarah, craftivism. How did you get into it, and what's your role within the movement?
I got into it 11 years ago, when I was a complete burnt-out activist. Worked as a professional campaigner for charities, was joining lots of activist groups, but not finding them very strategic or effective, sometimes demonising people or screaming at them or being violent or using activism as an excuse to do illegal stuff or antisocial stuff. And I'm an introvert. Mm-hmm. So much of it was so extrovert that was exhausting and not using my skill set. And I got into craft because on a train to Glasgow with my work, I was doubting the effectiveness of teaching activism in my job.
But did you buy a colouring in book? Is that what you
I
tell
bought
me?
a cross stitch kit about this big of a teddy for a fiver.
For a child, child's cross-stitch kit, basically.
Yeah, because I thought, I've never cross-stitched, but it's cheap. And one of the great things about craft is it's not scary, like a blank canvas. I just thought, I'll learn how to do my crosses. And I wanted to use my hands, so I really missed using my hands. I was feeling anxious and burnt out and worried, and I thought, this will give me something to do where it's creative but not too scary.
Sarah realised she could use cross-stitch for kinder activism. The word craftivism was coined by an American, Betsy Greer, in 2003, in response to seeing people use craft to discuss change. Sarah's approach to craftivism is to use it as gentle protest, in part inspired by Indian civil rights activist and leader Mahatma Gandhi, who famously used non-violent campaigns to protest against British rule. Images of Gandhi that still resonate today show him spinning yarn to encourage Indians to boycott British-made textiles and wear homemade cloth.
So, Sarah, show me some of your stuff.
So they're all different objectives for different projects, but one of them is making mini protest banners, which is the first project I did with the cross stitch, and you hang them off eye level for people to find.
Right, I'm going to read this one out loud. I can't save the world on my own. I need your help. And then in brackets, please, which is a sort of gentle, polite activist sort of...
And we've got, Superman.
Superman.
So Superman's saying it.
But he's saying it with a please.
Yeah. So for this, you could put it in a park about climate change. People can take pictures. It's for people to walk past, spot, wafting in the wind,
and interact. And children will notice this as well, because it's so bright and colourful.
Yeah.
The only problem is, I would have a real problem with giving this away.
I know.
Because and I have would hoard.
And I have to tell people, remember you're doing it for the cause
yeah,
and not your love
be
of craft.
So proud.
But then you'd be even more proud to give it away, and you could take a picture of it, share it on social media, which works really well.
Sarah leads workshops in craftivism, encouraging anyone interested as to how they can be change makers.
I know there's people in the room who've never picked up a needle and thread before, but don't be scared.
It's really nice to do something where you kind of stop and think and really engage with the kind of topic that you're thinking about. There's a lot of anger in the world, but we need stuff that's going to be positive, that's going to affect change as well.
What's really cool about it is it's a really respectful form of activism. It's really gentle, but I think just as provocative, if not more, than the kind of aggressive politics that has kind of plagued some of our social media recently.
This is quite a good way of doing something rather than just shouting about it, I think, you know, and I think people love a gift, don't they?
In workshops with the Girl Guides, Sarah helped devise the new craftivism badge. And her campaigns have achieved success. Don't Blow It was a message stitched onto hankies and given away as gifts to the board members of Marks & Spencer's.
We gave handkerchiefs to say, we love your organisation. One of the things we're shocked that you don't do is pay the living wage. And it makes business sense as well as dignity for your staff. And the chair of the board took me aside at the AGM and said it was the most powerful campaign they'd ever experienced. And they announced they were paying the living wage to 50,000 staff. So most activism is a surprise because it's a march, it's a stunt, you know, it's a milkshake being thrown at you, but that's a bad surprise. If you give a good surprise, so if I gave you this hanky that you didn't know of and clearly I like had learnt a bit about you and made it bespoke for you and it had taken hours to do, it's creating dopamine in your body.
Pleasure.
Pleasure.
So just as it should give pleasure in the making, it should also give pleasure in the giving. Sarah's going to teach me how to be a guerrilla craftivist.
Okay, Sarah. Where to park?
Yeah.
What are you thinking?
I'm thinking where to put it. So I reckon here, because you've got a lovely tree, bit of grass, so it'll be a good photo for social media.
Got the railings to hang it to. So it's a prime location.
Prime location. And normally I do it off eye level, but I reckon he is quite pretty.
I like it.
Yeah.
Let me be your glamorous assistant.
You hold that.
Okay. What happens if the police come? Do we run?
Then you take a picture and then you snip it off because you're not causing any permanent damage.
And it's not vandalism, is it?
No, it could be seen as littering, or if it was a hateful message, it'd be hate crime, but this isn't.
So
it's nice crime.
It's nice crime. It's not crime,
it's
Jenny.
It's not crime.
It's beautiful.
It's just nice.
And then I'm going to take a picture.
Doesn't that look splendid?
And what's great is with the picture on social media, you can link it more to the issue and people will see it offline. So again, it's good form of activism because it's very shareable.
Okay, now what about a picture with me next to it?
Jenny, no, it's not about you. I don't need a picture of you. It's about the message and the cause. So you could share it on your Twitter and say, have a link to actions people can take on climate change. It's not about you, love.
I'm learning.
If you do that, people would go, does she care about the cause or does she just care about herself?
The penny is very slowly dropping. Right, and we shall walk off now as if we weren't there and we didn't do anything.
We didn't
anyway.
Do it. Someone else did it. It wasn't us.
Sarah says craftivism is the catalyst, not the conclusion. I feel quite humbled by it all, to be honest. But she's got me buzzing and has given me a list of other craftivists in the UK who I can call on to find out more about their campaigns. I've come to Bradford-on-Avon in Wiltshire to meet a graphic designer turned craftivist, Helen Baker, who has a tiny pant production line going on in her kitchen.
So we are making some tiny weeny knickers today.
Yes.
They are a representation for women to understand the importance of smear testing, of cervical screening, because currently cervical screening rates are at a 20-year low.
Why do you think that is?
Well, some national findings have shown that two of the main barriers that are stopping women from attending are embarrassment and body image, particularly in 25 to 29-year-olds, as one in three of that age group are skipping appointments.
But do you think there are actually young girls who think my vagina and my vulva are ugly, so I don't want to go and show it to a nurse?
Yes. This campaign is meant to say it doesn't matter what your lady garden looks like. Mm-hmm. It actually doesn't stop the nurses doing their job at all.
I have never shaved or waxed my bikini area in my life.
But a lot of women are put off because they think they need to do maintenance beforehand.
Yeah, but they're not trying to get off with the nurse.
No.
Do you know what I mean? The nurse isn't interested.
No,
she's
exactly.
A busy woman.
Helen and fellow craftivists have been making hundreds of pairs of these miniature knickers for Cervical Screening Awareness Week. Last year, a chocolatier even made chocolate pants to give out as gifts.
The focus for the pants is to make them eye-catching, to make them beautiful, to make people stop and look. So people were encouraged to make these pants and during the awareness week to drop their pants in public somewhere, yeah. Whether it's on a community notice board, in a restaurant, on...
You mean drop a pair of pants like this?
Their pants, their own pants.
Well, don't encourage me. See, what you could do, a less impressive campaign or a less effective campaign would just put that on the back of a toilet door,
yes.
Which is fine. It's information, you know, women are sitting on the loo. We might read it. This and this together, yeah. You've got a present.
Yeah, and I think when something's handcrafted, people appreciate the time and effort and energy that's gone into it. So I normally do a back part, often in felt, and then a contrasting front.
So that's the back of the pant, that's the buttock catcher, and then that's the front piece.
Exactly.
Lovely.
Yeah. So we've got here some brightly coloured felt, some fabric that I've been collecting
for
most of my
life. Can I bag that?
You can. I thought you might like that one.
It's lovely.
It is. And then there's some ribbons and little bows and roses and sort of extra bits to stick on as well, just to make it really bright and eye-catching for whoever might be passing by.
Marvellous. Well, I always say, you know, I have very high blood pressure because I get very angry. I think that with me and the menopause, most of my symptoms were emotional rather than physical. Huge rage.
Mm-hmm.
Huge. Absolutely. Yeah, I know.
Watch the scissors.
Very, very, very frightening woman I turned into. So, painting, knitting, tapestry, all the things I now use to slow me down, calm me down.
And that sense of achievement afterwards.
God, I could become obsessive. I do everything like a bull in a china shop. I always have. And then it's always what disappoints me in the end, because my stuff is always a bit scruffy. If I slow down more...
Yeah, I know what you mean, but craftivism is actually meant to be slow.
Where have you put these in the past?
Well, I usually keep a stash of them in my bag, and wherever I go,
so pubs,
I will drop them.
Ladies'
yeah,
loos.
Yeah, exactly. But they have found themselves in all sorts of places. There was a French garter maker who did a little tiny 3D pair of silk knickers. They looked absolutely beautiful. And she put them on a Eurostar to Brussels. They've been in the Question Time toilets at the BBC. There's even been a pair in Senegal and Africa. So that's what's been amazing about using social media, and in particular Instagram and the maker community, because they have just embraced this brief, pun intended.
Got it.
And really just made it their own.
I'd wear these if I could squeeze into them. I am more than delighted with that.
Perfect.
What a fabulous thing to find on the back of a toilet door. I'm a bit competitive. I sort of always do things thinking, is my one really good?
Well, there's
do
no...
I have to let that go?
Yeah, you do. There's no scoring, no judging. It's just about making and passing a message on.
How am I going to change?
Make lots of pants and put them out into the world and you'll learn to let go.
Do you think?
I do think so.
So we set off on our mission to town to drop our knickers for the We're All Smear Ready campaign. I'm feeling like a frontline activist. Jane Fonda, eat your heart out.
Where are we going?
This shop here.
Our first stop's a gift shop, where Helen helps me seek a good spot for my first ever drop.
OK. This is a very good spot.
Yeah, this is a good shop.
OK, so I'm looking for somewhere to drop my pants. Where do you think I should go?
Somewhere where lots of people will see it. How about in the window somewhere?
Oh, in the window. Good idea, good thinking. Look, a couple of mannequins.
Oh, yeah, perfect.
Perfect, perfect. Do you want to take myself? I'll drop that in there, just in case. I'm not littering on the job. There we go. It's really sneaky. Undercover.
Perfect. I like it.
Thank you. I'm going to take a photo. This is ideal.
Perfect.
Look, there's no one here. Right, so I just...
Peel off the back.
I'm going to just lightly stick it to the mirror. Eyeline there.
Great.
Very good job. Right, on to the next.
Yeah. So, what about just here?
Okay.
Would be perfect.
I love that my pants are encouraging others to have smear tests. I'm really struck by the kinds of issues that craftivism takes on in today's Britain. Deep in the heart of Kent, near Canterbury, lives another craftivist, motivated by Sarah Corbett's Craftivist Collective. Katie Stiles is an unpaid carer for her husband, Mark.
What have we got tomorrow?
So we've got the vehicle with the Motor Neurone Disease Association.
Mark has a rare form of motor neuron disease called Kennedy's disease, which is a slowly progressive muscle wasting disease, and means that he has difficulties with his balance, with swallowing, with moving around, with fiddly things like buttons and shoelaces. It's a challenge, but you learn to adapt. many people don't recognise themselves as carers. I know I didn't. I found out that I was a carer rather than a wife to my husband in a meeting. And it's really important that you identify as a carer, because it means that you can get extra support with things like training in first aid or support groups, so you can meet up with other carers. I realised what an amazing concept craftivism was, particularly for carers. You can't really go on protests. You can't really leave the person that you're caring for and go and wave your banner up in London or wherever it is. But you may still want to support a cause.
Katie's first endeavour at craftivism was to slave away on the stove, making chili jam, and she embroidered colourful tops for the jars. These chili jams were presented to members of Parliament, asking them to reflect on the colossal additional costs those with MND and their families face each year, for things like home adaptations and additional heating.
One jar of chili jam.
It was a play on words, because people couldn't afford to keep their heating on because of the extra cost. And so, you know, people would have been chilly. I started the We Care campaign when government failed to publish the carer strategy. I got really, really excited that they were looking at a strategy for carers, because we all knew that we needed some new things in there. And what happened was we all wrote in and sent our information off to the government department, and then they sat on it and didn't use it. And we all felt that we were stretched too thin, a bit like a sticking plaster, holding the health and social care systems together. And following on from that, we decided recently that we would do a sticking plaster piece of craftivism to send to our MPs to remind them that carers felt like this. So I'm just stitching padded bit, two pieces of felt together using a running stitch. I think the very act of actually encouraging people, especially carers, to sit down and take a little bit of time out and slow down and breathe and take their time over a piece and not worry about it being perfect is a very powerful thing.
Katie, Sarah, Helen, Lauren, and, well, me, if I'm allowed to include myself in the gang, are not the first female activists to use craftivism. It has deep roots. Over 100 years ago, we had the suffragettes, who were well known for their factions of radical activists, but they also had craftivists. They used embroidery skills to create intricate yet eye-catching banners. And just as today's craftivists use social media, the suffragettes were adept at using the media of the time, newspaper photographs, and this new technology, film. Go further back to the 18th century, and you've got famous British potter and entrepreneur Josiah Wedgwood making this beautiful crafted cameo brooch, distributed for free to raise awareness for the campaign to abolish the slave trade. And when the Windrush generation arrived in post-war Britain, it brought over a Caribbean tradition of craftivism, Dorcas clubs. Something descendant Rose Sinclair has been exploring and revisiting with others.
My form of craftivism is I set up front room spaces and invite people into craft, and into a space that might have Caribbean music playing. I make rum cakes and traditional recipes like gazardas and coconut drops and peanut drops, so they have things to nourish. Because Caribbean food, you can't come into a house and not feed people. And then we have the making. And I found that creating little weaving looms allowed 10 to 15 minutes of just people sitting down and being calm. So with all of those things happening together, people feel that they're in a home. So the space is decorated in such a way that people sit, relax, and we make. And in that making, the conversation starts to flow. Many people, when they're making, reference the Windrush scandal. This has become very important to them because they're remembering their parents, they're remembering migration, some of the issues that their parents have faced in trying to settle here. And so I use my space as a safe space for them to tell their stories.
The Windrush scandal centres around the government's tightening of immigration policy and individuals from the Windrush generation being detained or deported because of lost papers.
This is a real pretty example of my mum's crochet from 1960. So the story is that she started this when she was travelling from Jamaica on the SS Montserrat, but it never got finished. What I would normally do, every so often I pick it up and do another chain. It's still unfinished, which reminds me that the stories of black women and their crafting practices is still unfinished.
Rose's front rooms represent the space where Dorcas clubs would meet and craft. Dorcas clubs are popular in the Caribbean, and migrating Windrush women brought the clubs with them. They'd make gifts for those in need and sell what they made to raise money to help their community and those back home.
It's called Dorcas because it's named after a woman in the New Testament in Acts chapter 9. She's called, if I paraphrase it, a maker of cloth. But one of the things that she did was take women who were destitute and teach them to be makers of cloth so they could then fend for themselves. For a lot of women, it was deemed as being beneficial to give back and using your talent as a maker. So it was intergenerational. From your older women all the way down to your younger women. If you could bake, if you could sew, if you could weave baskets, it was a gift. As a child, I just remember sitting around these women, making and talking. And that's why I use the front room space, because it has a memory.
Rose sets up her front room workshops in museums, colleges and shopping centres as a way to encourage conversation while crafting, just like Dorcas women have done for decades.
This is a history that needs to come into our being and our knowledge, and it's a collective space of saying we can make a change. I think black women have always crafted. I think they've always made and exchanged. I think they just didn't call it craftivism.
What Rose said was very touching. I'm realising that craftivism is about starting conversations, but it also commemorates things that should never be forgotten. I've come to the charity Project East in London's Mile End to see for myself part of a memorial quilt made in Britain.
So, Ian, this is extraordinary because I vaguely knew what I was going to see, but when you walk into this room and you actually see it in person, it's very affecting. Tell us what it actually is.
Yeah, so this is the UK AIDS Memorial Quilt, and each panel was stitched and designed and made by family members who had lost people to AIDS in the 80s and 90s. They have all been handmade. They're an incredibly powerful tribute to family members. These are called blocks. They're 12 feet by 12 feet, and there's 48 of these large blocks. And within each block, there's about 8 panels each that are 3 feet by 6 feet.
There's a significance to that measurement, which I've kind of... I'm working through it. Is it a coffin size?
Exactly. So when it was conceived in 1985, the idea would be that each panel would be the size of a coffin, just to make it that much more powerful.
Ooh. Does it make you cry? Because this is just completely... And I'm a horrible old bag. Nothing makes me cry. This has absolutely choked me up. And it's just such a loving thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I've had a relationship with the AIDS quilt since probably 1988, and every time I've seen it, I can't walk away untouched.
Let's have a closer look. Let's get down, have a look at this. This is a beauty, isn't it, to Stevie?
Yeah, absolutely. So all of them are incredibly powerful, but obviously Stevie, the amount of detail. So this is all hand embroidered. So this must have taken months of the family members who created it.
It might have been quite a communal effort, you know, it might have been a lot of people together, getting together and doing this on behalf of Stevie. Yeah. You know, this fabulous one there where you've got, you know, even the cuddly toy, you've got broken hearts, you've got records. You know that Phil liked to have fun. And there's personalities are coming through these quilts, aren't they?
No, absolutely. And each one is so personal. I find it so intimate. You really see that it humanizes, I think, the disease and the virus, and it moves it away from the statistics.
You know, some of them, the dates of birth and dates of deaths, which kind of just brings it home how you know, we lost so many young men in the prime of their lives. There's somebody there, my math isn't very good, but 1951 to 1993, 42.
Yeah, no, absolutely. A generation lost, as they say. The thing that really quite strikes me is a lot of the dates of these. So they all predate just by a few years the more scientific advancements that came with HIV medication. So antiretroviral therapies came in 95, 96. So a lot of them, if you know, it was just a few years before the really advanced medication came onto the scene.
The idea for an AIDS memorial quilt began in 1985 by AIDS activist Cleve Jones. It was last displayed in full on Washington, D.C.'s Mall in 1996. The American quilt now has about 48,000 sections, weighing an estimated 54 tons. It's the largest piece of community folk art in the world. The UK AIDS Memorial Quilt is much smaller. There are 384 names, looked after by a partnership of 6 AIDS charities.
It's very important, isn't it, that young people and teenagers today see this?
Absolutely. Well, it was developed as a tool to educate. It was developed to be a tool to dispel stigma and discrimination. It was very much an activist tool, so I think that still is applicable today. I think you can't see the AIDS quilt and not walk away untouched. I think it's a very powerful reminder of the war that was happening, I think, in the 80s and 90s.
Well, it's a sort of alternative, you know, when you see war memorials and they're normally just, you know, they're on stone and
exactly.
It's very sort of regimented. You know, these are the personalities coming through.
Exactly.
I'd love to see some more.
Yeah, absolutely. So if Clifford and Siobhan from the food chain, part of the partnership, are here to, we could display some more of the blocks.
Oh, thanks ever so much, you two. This is brilliant. Thank you. Aha, 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 aha. Anthony Perkins.
Yeah, who starred in Psycho, the famous Alfred Hitchcock film. And this one is brilliant because they've stitched in a shower curtain. So for the famous shower curtain
They really
scene.
Have. I mean, it's macabre, it's funny, it's witty, it's loving, it's a homage. And as I presume, the very glittery Sylvester.
Absolutely. So that one obviously is a reflection of Sylvester as a person, so quite flamboyant. Disco performer.
It's a great shame that this UK AIDS quilt doesn't have a home big enough to display it in its entirety. But the exhibition size needed would be enormous. 48 of these blocks of panels would cover over 600 square metres.
This is really, really moving, and I'm so thrilled I've been able to see, you know, even some of it. Really am. And you do hope that the people that made the panels got some comfort from making a panel.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's very much a form of kind of collective catharsis.
I might have to go and blow my nose.
You're not alone.
I shouldn't have been so surprised by how upsetting I found that. But I was really upset. I think that you'd have to be made of stone, in actual fact, for that not to affect you. It's an incredible, important piece of work. And I feel really glad that I've seen it. I'd love to see it all in one piece. But
it strikes me that there's two types of craftivism. Direct action, like the hanky and sticking plaster campaigns, and using craft to raise awareness, like the AIDS quilt. And it cuts across continents. Craftivism is global, and it's happening right now. I started looking around to see what else is out there. And I was intrigued to discover that in Chile's capital of Santiago, there's a delightful group called Hombres Tejedores. That's Spanish for men who knit.
Hombres Tejedores are craftivists. We express ourselves through knitting. We protest through knitting. When I was a kid, around 7 years old, I asked my grandmother to teach me how to crochet until my father realized that, and he told her not to do it anymore because that was not an activity for boys. When I found out about Hombres Tejedores, I started following them on Instagram and Facebook.
So the whole setting was created for us to talk about masculinity, about gender roles, about what it meant for us as men to be in a space trying to learn something that was pretty much always related to women.
Buoyed by the reactions they received to their all-male knitting group, the men took knitting and a whole bunch of pink wool out into the open.
So we decided to do our first intervention in the financial district in Santiago. And we thought about wearing suits and ties because we wanted to portray this whole idea of a masculine figure doing something that has always been related to women, which is knitting. We were all super dressed up with these suits and ties. It was black and gray, most of us. And then we decided to pull out our pink yarns, very strong color. So we stayed there for a couple of hours. What we really wanted was to see people's reactions that day. But yes, this whole idea of deconstructing this masculine figure, doing something feminine, that was super interesting.
Soon the hombres would use their crochet and knitting skills to create a symbolic craftivist piece, sparked by the police killing of a Mapuche activist, Camilo Catrianca.
The Mapuche people are indigenous people of Chile who live in the south of the country, and they have fought for a long time for their rights, for their land and their beliefs. We in Hombres Tejedores realized that we needed to say something about it.
This is a Mapuche flag that we knitted with more than 300 people. So it's like 600 different squares to complete the work. The yellow circle in the middle is what we call a cultrún. It's basically like a Mapuche drum. It's very beautiful and has a very beautiful sound.
A year after Catrianca's death, in October 2019, the biggest protest in Chile's history took place, as its people rallied against authorities on low wages, rising living costs, and inequality. When it turned violent, large numbers of protesters were injured when police responded with pepper gas and rubber bullets. Many suffered eye injuries or lost their sight.
During the protests, the eye symbol started to be very important, and people basically covered one of their eyes to show support and anger. And, well, paints like this started to appear everywhere in the cities.
So these are the eyes that we crocheted and clipped on the flag to show support to all the people that lost one of their eyes or both of their eyes. That red eye right in the middle, dripping blood, is the one I crocheted, showing that people were bleeding from the eyes.
If the work that we do as hombres tejedores can inspire other people to do their own fight, I think that's something really good. And to me, doing this at this time of my life, it's really, really inspiring.
The hombres and their brilliant knitting have shown us that men can be craftivists too. But I was wondering if there are many male craftivists in Britain. And it turns out there are. And you'll find them in some surprising places.
When you walk through a storm.
Craftivism can be a beautiful, gentle way to protest, but it can also be a direct way to uplift and unite. This is true for one man whose phrases and slogans have always brought people together. He's made banners for his football team, Liverpool, for nearly five decades.
At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song.
I'm an artivist, I'm a craftivist, you know. So this season I've made about 15 banners. I've got about four or five that are about one just started, a couple of others that are to be finished, a couple on the go.
Then we just get on with cutting the letters out.
The fans are the effing football. It's a phrase that I've taken from people saying, football without fans is nothing.
Shall, the final F. All right, shall.
When I go to a football match, I don't just go to watch a game, I go to participate, and that's why I make banners. And so that banner is saying, you know, the fans are the effing football, that they make football what it is. There's a kind of tribal thing to banners that, you know, that you're saying that this is who I am and this is the group that I belong to. You know, you follow the history of banners and you go back to the flags of armies of long, long time, back to the Romans. They have standards, don't they, at the front as they go marching. They represent who you are and the community that you're with.
Peter has created acclaimed banners. Some in tribute to his favourite musicians, like David Bowie. And this 3D banner, multi-textured and created from an old duffel coat. This is Peter's tribute to an esteemed Liverpool fan, the late comedy writer Eddie Brabham, best known for his Morecambe and Wise scripts.
It's called Eddie TV. It has a portrait of Eddie in the middle of it, which was painted by my friend, and a line, "Hop along, Cassidy wears 10-gallon nappies," which is the first joke that he'd ever sold and his most
popular joke was Morecambe and Wise were in bed and a police car passes the house.
He's not going to sell much ice cream going at that speed, is he?
Eddie was a great Liverpool supporter, and we took the banner to the match and took his daughter with us as well. So she went the match one more time with her dad.
Peter's fast reactions have helped him create banners to show support for other fans too. Like the one he made for Sean Cox, a Liverpool fan grievously attacked by a Roma supporter during the European Cup semi-finals and who was left fighting for his life.
I said, I just hope that Sean gets to see it and one day gets to hold it, because he was in intensive care at the time. So that started a train of support that ended up raising the money to pay for his rehabilitation, his care. And there was a picture sent when Liverpool won the title of Sean in bed with the banner over him. It's brilliant. But, you know, that's the best possible use a banner can come to, that you make a banner to show some support and empathy with or sympathy for people, and then that banner becomes a rallying point to make that support tangible.
In April 1989, the worst football tragedy in British history happened. 96 Liverpool fans were killed at the Hillsborough Stadium in Sheffield. Peter was there and got caught up in the fatal human crush.
I was in Pen 3 and carried out unconscious. I went through a near-death experience in the pens and was rescued and recovered by other Liverpool supporters, as far as I know. The day after Hillsborough, I went to the grounds with another of the lads who had gone the match with the day before and left tribute at the Shankly Gates, and then went to a friend's house, Fred Brown. I said to him, Fred, we're going to make a banner. So we translated the idea for this banner I was making for the Liverpool Football Club centenary, and that became the original Hillsborough Memorial banner. So I dedicated the banner to keep alive the names and memory of those who were killed, and that was its purpose.
A fortnight after the disaster, the banner was chosen to hang at the memorial service in Liverpool's Anglican Cathedral. 20 years later, after the original banner became battered and torn, Peter made a second memorial banner, adding the first names of all those killed and using different textures to explore all the senses. Both banners were used as a direct call to action.
It became, you know, a symbol of those who were affected by Hillsborough, you know, of the fight for justice and accountability, yeah. To present their names like that was to say that, you know, they're not forgotten. I don't make memes, I don't make internet pictures for, you know, I make real banners. I make things that people put their hands to. I make things that people see with their own eyes, in real life, in fresh air. It's, you know, to me, it's real. They're made to generate energy in the players. They're made to generate will amongst the supporters. They're about real people in a real place, in a real time. Yeah, I mean, to see that, that's the magic of it. To take that stencil off is the magic of creation, you know. It's, you know, artistic creation. Boss, isn't it?
As football matches played in closed stadiums during the COVID pandemic, Peter's form of craftivism, banners, could still be seen at Anfield, representing the fans on the cop.
The best way you can represent football supporters without them being there is with banners, cover the cop in banners. And good enough, the club were in agreement to that. It just blew me cap off.
I love Peter's work. I love everybody's work. I've had such a brilliant time doing this show. I've learnt a lot and it's made me think, which is remarkable. I'm a very wordy person. I normally work, I'm a writer, so words are my thing. And I was thinking very much that I wanted to do my own piece of craftivism, and I was desperately trying to think of something as clever as Helen's cervical smear campaign. I couldn't think of anything, so I've decided to go a little bit more symbolic. And I decided that the only thing I can gift to the world at the moment is small pieces of luck. And so I asked Lauren, who we know also as Deadly Nightshade, to come up with this pattern for a four-leaf clover, which we all know is the emblem of luck. And she very brilliantly did this. And I am womanfully having a go myself, but I think we'll just put that down for the time being. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to place this somewhere locally so that I can gift somebody a little piece of luck, because I think that at the moment, that's what we all need more than anything else. What about the picture with me next to it?
Jenny, no, it's not about you.
Craftivism, really, the lesson I've learned is that it's about selflessness, and we do live in a selfie age. So it's a bit of an antidote to a lot of pressures that people are under. You can't do anything wrong. That's the other brilliant thing about craftivism, is that it's incredibly accepting. You're allowed to do what you want, say what you want, and give away a little piece of you so that other people can gain from that. I just think it's a really generous thing to do. So pick up your needles, pick up your scissors, your thread, your materials, your whatever. Be careful. If you're not an adult, go and get one. And enjoy it. And enjoy the sitting and thinking while you're doing it. And I do that right now, but I've got a big knot in my ball of wool. So, oh! Well, there we go. I shall continue.
It's serious business making a change in the world and trying to make things better, but it doesn't have to be a sullen and unhappy thing. You can laugh your head off and, you know, make the world a better place at the same time.
It really can be transformational, so I absolutely want everyone to see the power of gentle craftivism, and that anyone can do it, whether you're an introvert, extrovert, whether you see yourself as creative or not, we all are.
I'd say join in. Come and join in the group of people who are quietly changing people's minds.
More creative inspiration next on BBC4 with Make Craft Britain.